Goodness. Wow. Okay, we're letting the last flow in. Flow in this way. Good afternoon. My name is Doug Jones, and it's my absolute pleasure and privilege to welcome you today to the celebration of life for my father,
Hal Jones.
I'm just going to get this out as it's needed. We'll be fine. Okay. Before I really get started, I'd like to thank the Carden Hall family and the event planners and Mr. Durantes and his staff and everybody who just worked incredibly hard to pull this off. So many people in the Carden Hall family wanted this to be a perfect event, and the Jones family, we are immensely grateful. Thank you very much. Craig Peterson, are you here?
Yes.
Where are you?
Hi.
Oh, there you are over there. Wow. That's a shot. Yay. Thank you so much. That's art. I'm going to start with talking about Mr. Jones. Why does it say Mr. Jones on here instead of Albert Jones? Christy and I had a joke. It was actually a joke. It was actually a fact. That we would say, Dad, no response. Dad, no response. Mr. Jones, yes. It was really lovely that we had an article in the Daily Pilot, just a celebration of his life, and obviously the person who wrote it had never met Mr. Jones, because he called him Jones throughout the article. I had this mental image that I thought I'd share with you of this well-meaning man saying, hey, Jones, to my dad. And how Mr. Jones would have responded, probably with a great big smile, with a lot of steel behind it. You could call me Mr. Jones. And I think the man probably would. So, Dad did not want this event to take place. He was absolutely clear, no way. He was not fond of memorials. He found them sometimes tedious, often maudlin, and sometimes even downright depressing. So we had a lot of conversations in his last several months about how we didn't have to do it like that, and that there was so much joy in his life, and there's so much joy at this place, and all these wonderful people, that we could actually do more of a celebration. Having said that, I brought my hanky, and we may have some Kleenex boxes. I heard rumors of the Al Jones Memorial Kleenex boxes. Did those get done or not? Okay, good, that's great. Feel free, tears are, you know, well-wishing to the dead, I think. And I had a thought when I walked up that Dad would be utterly stunned to see you all here.
I think, he might actually be speechless. Maybe for the first time in his life. Okay.
All right. I'd like to start with three prayers. And because this is about Dad, we're going to do it a little differently. And I'm going to need your help with some of these. So the first prayer I'd like to offer is a prayer to God. And thank you, Lord. Or, thank you, Dad. I'm not quite sure which. We'll see. Sit, stay. Okay. I would like you to go inside and see if you can find one memory of Mr. Jones that you would find worthy of celebrating. Off you go. Because Dad was a diver, he would understand buoyancy. Now I'd like to have that memory become buoyant. And let's let it rise up to heaven. And as we do that, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, please feel our deep gratitude for sending this beautiful man into our lives, for the time we had with him, and for the lessons we learned from him. O Lord, we humbly ask you to bless and cherish the soul of Albert Holden Jones. May he rest in your peace and love forever. Amen. Yeah, that one got me too. I know. The family is now cheering up down here, myself included. It's a good thing the family's cheering up, because what's coming next is our second prayer. This one gets to stay here on earth. And this is a prayer for his two families. We have the immediate family here. Some people haven't seen in a while, starting with Mrs. Jones. Christy Kaltoff, her husband Mark, and several of her children. I'll name them in a bit. For me, I would love prayers. And for my wife, Marika, and my two children who are not able to be here today. And I see some Bass family and some family from the other side. It's great to have you here. The second family this prayer goes to is his extended family, which pretty much includes all of you. His Cardenhall family, his friends. Family was very important to Dad. And what I'd like is I'd like you to go inside once again and find a memory of joy and a memory of love that relates to Dad. Off you go. And if you would send that prayer outward to his family, both families, I would love to pray again. As a community, we offer a prayer for the immediate family and for the extended family of Albert Holden Jones. May our feelings of love and joy support and sustain us through this difficult time. Amen. One more prayer, and then we're going to move on. This was my dad's favorite prayer. I had the luxury of cleaning up some of his stuff. He had copies of this prayer in his dresser drawer. He had copies of this prayer in his office drawer. Everywhere. So I'm just going to say this one. This is the Sportsman's Prayer, and Christy and I know it word for word for going up. Dear Lord, in the battle that goes on through life, I ask but a field that is fair, a chance but to do my all in the strife, the courage to do and to dare. And if I should win, let it be by the code, with my faith and my honor held high. And if I should lose, let me stand by the road and cheer as the winner goes by. I have to tell you a story about this creature right here and about the Sportsman's Prayer. I want you to think for a minute, what would you do with your favorite prayer? Do you have a calligraphy or a nice laser print? One of the things Dad did about 35 years ago is he went to the Newport Beach sign department. He had it made up in galvanized, reflective, like the white speed limit sign. It's exactly the dead ringer for that. And he has the 8-line Sportsman's Prayer in reflective white and heavy black. And then, yeah, me too. Okay. He framed it in a 2x4, painted it, and stuck it up on the wall with nails. He had a term. He said, well, that's hell-bent for stout. Yes, it is, Dad. I had the vision of a thief coming in with a flashlight in the night and hitting that sign, it would reflect back. And I think that it probably 5,000 or 6,000 years from now, when the archaeologists are sifting through the rubble, of Cardin Hall, there will be a few things still existing. I think the sportsman's prayer will be one. I think this welded out of stainless steel creature has a good another 600 or 800 years in it. That's what I'm thinking. That's how Dad did things, and I love him for that. Okay. Moving on, at Cardin Hall we have a tradition of starting with a prayer and then a flag salute. Now, there's something about a flag salute that Dad loved. He loved his country. He was willing to die for this country. And when he said the flag salute, it had great richness and meaning. One of the things Dad hated about flag salutes is mindless droning. I pledge allegiance to the flag. So at Cardin Hall, we have a tradition of starting the flag salute with a reason to salute the flag, and then saluting. When you salute the flag, think about what it means to you, please. Mr. Jones would have loved that. And it's my pleasure to introduce Mr. Alec Church to lead us in the flag salute. Come on up, Alex. I'll leave my hanky up here in case you need it. Yes. Get over there.
That's great.
Okay. Good afternoon. During my time at Cardin Hall, I said the Pledge of Allegiance every morning at the start of school. Over the years, its significance changed for me as I came to understand the words I was saying and the message behind them. But the greatest change occurred in eighth grade when my friend Harrison and I volunteered for flag duty. To make sure that we knew how to do it properly, we met with Mr. Jones, and he showed us the right way to raise the flag, to wrap the line once around the pole, and to tie it to the cleat at the bottom. I still remember the exact knot he taught us to use. As I watched and listened to Mr. Jones, I began to realize something. As I noticed the care and reverence with which he handled the flag, I could see how personal it was to him. And I realized that it should be that personal to all of us. Our flag is not just a piece of cloth. It is a symbol. A symbol of America and all that our nation stands for. Hope, opportunity, and the freedom that we have to create our own future. But not only that, our flag represents the struggles of those who came before us, the hardships that they endured to secure a brighter future for us, and the sacrifices that they made to ensure that that star-spangled banner still waves, or the land of the free and the home of the brave. Will you please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance? Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Oh goodness. Dad loved family. Family was very important to him. And he particularly cherished his 7 grandchildren, 4 of whom made it here today. I'd just like to acknowledge the grandchildren who didn't make it. Rachel Kaltoff is at Notre Dame, teaching and finishing or working on her master's. An amazing young lady. My daughter Katya is in London, getting her master's. And my son, right about now, is in Dallas at a national fencing tournament. Go Simon. Okay. But we have Abigail and Phoebe and Noah and Peter here today who've come out to help us celebrate their grandfather. And I'm just so tickled to have them here. And I know that my dad would be just delighted to have you here. So well done. I get to introduce Pete. Peter Kaltoff. Hi, Pete. I'm going to embarrass you a little bit. Don't worry about it. Pete just got his black belt, and I thought, well, I have a black belt too. But there, you know, he had a black belt in Taekwondo. He's amazingly gifted. He's currently playing in the Michigan Youth Symphony Orchestra, and he's here to play his violin, a sonata in G minor. Please welcome Peter Kaltoff.
Oh, have fun.
sit, stay.
This is my lovely wife, Marika. More about her later. How do I honor my father? How do I celebrate an extraordinary life?
The best way I could think of to do it was to look at what I learned from him and what is carried forward in my life because of the gifts he gave me. It was very difficult to pick three. We were headed for a four-hour service otherwise. So I've limited myself to three short bits. This is the first. Learn something today. Tomorrow, learn something. How about the day after? Learn something. Dad learned things right up until his death. It was an extraordinary, extraordinary time to be with him because he stayed consistent. He learned things throughout his entire life, and at the end of his life, he was still going strong. We were doing some upgrades to the buildings, and he came up and wanted to look up in the ceiling. He couldn't get up to the roof, so we took pictures and brought the pictures to him. And he's like, oh, now I understand. Now I understand the engineering. He was so excited to learn. I think he loved to teach in part because he loved to learn, and he wanted to share both sides of that equation. Dad's love of learning was contagious. He wanted to infect every student at Cardin Hall with a passion to learn. And this was consistent for the 51 and a half years that I got to know him. I'm going to tell you a story about Greg Kelly. Greg, where are you? Hi, Greg. I'm going to embarrass you a little bit. I warned you, but here it comes. Okay. So I thought, how can I possibly celebrate Dad's life without a couple of good stories? There's no way. So this was at a Cardin Hall beach party in front of the 7th and 8th grade. And one of his favorite students came up and gave Dad a big hug from behind. At which point, Greg took flight. Upside down and over, and ended up with Mr. Jones over him, saying, Mr. Jones, it's Greg Kelly, Mr. And what was fascinating for me was it was a really challenging moment. Can you imagine the 7th and 8th graders? And they were freaked out. The staff was freaked out. You had an act of sudden, unexpected, and extreme violence from the director right in front of the students. Not optimal, shall we say that? And there was this general bit of freaked out. I wasn't at the party, but I was at the assembly next Monday because I talked with Dad about it. And he was utterly calm, which surprised me. And he said, oh no, Doug, this is a wonderful opportunity to teach. I can't wait. He must have said that thousands upon thousands of times. I heard him say those words. What a wonderful, freak out. Dad's saying, no, you know, actually, this is a wonderful opportunity to teach. And it was one of the best assemblies I heard him give. He talked about the choice that a person can make in a moment when they're held, whether they surrender their liberty or they fight for their liberty. And he said, I was a warrior. I was trained to fight for mine, and I am not surrendering my liberty without a fight. The 7th and 8th graders at the assembly were riveted. They'd never thought anything like that. And I would wager a fair amount of money that they all remember that assembly. He encapsulated this love of learning with a sign that's in the long tunnel. The first part of it says, enter to learn. But Dad didn't stop there. Why? What is the point of learning? Which is a really good question for an educator to ask. Why do we do this? And there are a number of excellent answers. The one he chose that's up on the sign, you come in, it says enter to learn. You go out in big letters, it says go forth to serve. And he believed that one of the reasons to learn was so that you could act in service of your fellow man more effectively, more powerfully, and with great excellence. I hope you get to look at that sign. One more bit about that before we move on. That sign to me, I call the remember sign. as he put it there ostensibly for the students. And I have a hunch that Dad put it there for Dad. Because we get so busy in our life. I got a celebration of life right now. I got to go. I walked right under that sign, didn't look. I thought, wait a minute. I think Dad looked every time to remind himself, remember to learn today, and then remember to do something with what you have learned. Thanks, Dad. That was a good one. About 2 weeks after Dad passed, the staff got together. We had an all-staff meeting, and it was a wonderful cathartic event. The staff had been amazing. I was allowed to fall apart after Dad passed. I was at the beach home, and I didn't have to do anything. The staff had to hear about it and go teach, which, wow. One of the staff members who spoke was Mrs. Bass, and she just brought the house down. I thought she was terrific. And she's very, very generously agreed to come share some of her recollections of Mr. Jones. Please give a warm welcome to Mrs. Bass. Okay. Back up. Okay.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. So, you know, the meeting to which Mr. Doug Jones is referring is a little bit less intimidating than this gathering here. But I promise that I will do my very best to honor our friend and colleague and mentor, Mr. Jones. So when Mr. Jones died, when I came home, I told my husband what had happened, and we were talking about him. And he, my husband Mike, was talking about his memories of Mr. Jones. And when we first began to come to school here, my son Peter was, he's 31 now, so he was going to begin first grade. So it was a little years ago. So we came to get our tour, and Mr. Jones was our tour guide. So we didn't realize that we had hit the jackpot by having him give us our tour. But I know that when we went through the school, we were so impressed by what we saw in the classrooms. And I remember in one classroom in particular, it was in the room 10 corridor, the classroom was actually applauding for a student who was answering a question. And everyone was so eager to share their knowledge that we went home thinking, this place is really awesome because it's kind of cool to be smart. And that was a really neat thing for us. But after we had our tour, we were Mr. Jones escorted us into his office, so he, you know, closed that pocket door that you all are familiar with, and we got to sit in those two, I call them captain's chairs, and he sat behind his big, clean desk, and went on to tell us about the bottom line of the school. So he said that he runs his school like a business, and that, of course, piqued my husband's interest because he's a businessman, and he said there's no fundraisers. So we're thinking, yes, no jogathons, no selling chiclets or magazines or whatever. And he said, there's no donations. We don't accept donations. I've had families come want to put a gymnasium out there in deepest, darkest. But no, this school belongs to the children. So people that have offered to do donations have been turned away from that because we want this to be the children's school. So you won't find a building with a name of Mrs. So-and-so on it or a plaque with a bunch of names. And we thought that was really terrific. When I think of Mr. Jones, I have three areas that kind of mean the most to me. So, of course, for I think all of us, it's his assemblies. So I'm going to ask you with your applause, if you wouldn't mind, who remembers? Mr. Big, can you help me? So this was when Mr. Jones, he said of a story once about how parents would oftentimes come into the office and say, do you have a pencil? Or, do you have a phone? And he would be sitting in his office thinking, gosh, you know, there's a better way to approach that. Of course we have phones, we're at school and pencils, yes, but the asking part was lost on these parents. So he knew there was a better way to get better results. So he was talking about the fact that he went to a hardware store to get a little clinky dink of some kind and went up to the man and said, will you please help me? And it made the man feel about 10 feet tall, and he got what he needed in a nice way, and everybody was a win-win for everybody. So that was one thing. One of my most favorite assemblies is one that he used called the ladder of listening. And every year I write the words L-A-D-D-E-R on my classroom because, of course, Mr. Jones talks to us all at assemblies, and we as teachers go back into our classrooms and kind of digest what he said and put it in terms that, in my case, 7 and 8 year olds can understand. And the L, if you don't remember, was for look. So I think we all maybe could use, at times, a brush up on how to be better listeners. So look at the person. The A in ladder is for ask questions. The first D he used was for don't interrupt. The next D is don't change the subject. The E was to engage in the topic of conversation. And the R was to respond. And I remember that he talked about a friend of his that when he spoke to him, he would always nod his head like, got it, got it, got it. So just those little things help us to keep listening going. And I use that every year, and every year since I've heard that. Another tip he had for being a good listener was to try, to be patient, and to ask questions. Use the term push your brains. He talked about tact being manners in action. One of his favorite topics we all talk about often is property and how there are three forms of that. And one time at an assembly, Mr. Jones was talking about, you know, your being as property, your physical property, and that there was a Halloween party somewhere and a Cardin Hall student, and he was saying this at the assembly, which I thought was kind of brave of him, a Cardin Hall student was goofing around with his costume and he ended up losing his eye. And I remember my class looked at me like, and it really like set them aback about that. His point was not to take unnecessary risks with yourself. So that was a big aha thing for my class, and that all property has an owner. He talked about once going to, I think, the swap meet or someplace and misplacing his keys. So he went to Mr. Big and said, Mr. Big, will you help me? I've lost my keys. And he said, well, I've got a lot of keys here. How do I know these are your keys? And he said, well, mine have my initials etched on them, AJ. Well, here you go. So he'd always make us a point of us labeling property. It's, you know, nice to have property, take care of it, label it. I think for the staff, our favorite assembly, let's hear it by the round of applause you give for Buddy the Blind Horse, right? The man drove his truck into a ditch. He was out in the middle of nowhere in farmland. He walks to the farm, asks the man at the farm, could you help me? I've got my truck's in the ditch. Sure. Brings his horse up there and hitches him up to the truck. And the man yells, pull, Coco, pull! And the horse stands there. And pull, Thunder, pull! Nothing. Pull, Buddy, pull! And he pulls that truck right out of the ditch. And the man said, well, I don't understand. How come your horse didn't move when you were calling the horse's name? So he goes, well, Buddy's blind. And he won't work unless he knows he's got his team with them. So it was like a little teamwork exercise. He talked about loyalty, and it takes three forms, which I love so much. God, your maker, first. Family, next. And your job. And of course, for students, we say, your job is to be a good student. Your job is to learn. That's your job here. Another favorite memory of mine is when Mr. Jones, in a kind of more recent assembly, talked about when he was a little boy, he went to a movie that was kind of a scary movie. And when he came home, he was having a hard time falling asleep because the scary movie was still in him. So his mom came in and said, Albert, what's the matter? He goes, oh, that movie, I'm so afraid of, you know, that theme is still with me. And she said, Albert, just remember this. There is no spot where God is not. So that was a really comforting little phrase that I think we all maybe tuck away. I know between you and me and deepest darkest, that was what I said before I walked up this stage. So then you fast forward to when Mr. Jones was doing his Navy SEAL work to become a Navy SEAL and just his training exercises when he was one. And he said to the students, I was up on a cliff in San Diego looking down at the ocean and the rocky shore, and he was feeling a little afraid. And remember what his mom said, there is no spot where God is not. So imagine this giant man who is so powerful and strong going to the edge of the cliff, looking out and yelling, "There is no spot where God is not," and jumping down into that shoreline. That, to me, said a whole lot about Mr. Jones and his character. Another thing I remember about Mr. Jones was when we were maybe in the olden-ish days, we used to have our conferences with Mr. Jones in his office with the parents. And usually when you have a conference that you call, there might be a reason that you're trying to help the student be better in their job as a student. And one theme that sometimes I would bring up was that daydreaming was maybe part of this child's day. And so Mr. Jones said, you know, daydreaming is a wonderful gift that we've been given. It's great for repetitive tasks, he would say, like painting a fence or sweeping out the garage. But when you're in school, there is no place for that. So your mind has to be, you know, focused on your schoolwork. And I liked that parents would hear that, because I'd hope that they would go home and relay that to their children. He talked about, when we would talk about your child struggles with direction following, he would say, he would, with his own children, you know, build upon a direction, give one and then another and another. And if it didn't happen, he would give a consequence. He used the expression, and I'm assuming that it's true, that he would tell his children, then I'm sorry, bedtime might be, you know, 15 minutes early or 5 minutes early, but have a consequence in mind. And I use that today all the time. And then one other theme that I had was people that are students that want to be perfectionists. And he said, you know, that, he would tell the parents, is sort of like a recipe for failure, because you can't achieve perfection. And I love the phrase that he gave them to use as a substitute, which your child can strive for excellence. And I think that is a perfect phrase to use for those high-achieving students. Let them strive for excellence. Then my last little part is the fact that Mr. Jones was a Navy SEAL. And he, I've told people before, was that rare combination of Rambo and Mr. Rogers. So he was able to, in my mind anyway, he had those giant hands, and I could just see him at battle grabbing some guy by the neck and just popping his head off. I knew he could. And then he would turn around and say, "Boys and girls, let's talk about kindness." Who else? I mean, only Mr. Jones could do that. He was one tough hombre for sure. He told me once, as you know, at the end of our school years, the teachers have a review meeting with Mr. Jones. And one, well, at the beginning of my career here, I started here 19 years ago, it was always so intimidating to go into his office. But then as I, you know, came each year more and more time, it became to be more of a friendly, less intimidating place for me. So we became more like friends during this meeting. He'd always say, "What a great job I do as a teacher," which is very kind. But then he would say, "Do you mind if I tell you a little story?" No, and I would listen to his stories all day long if I could. And he was talking about the fact that when he had turned 80, his family took him down to San Diego to the naval base where the SEALs thing was. And he got to go revisit his time there and what a special day that was. And another teacher once told me, her name is Mrs. Johnson, that she took Mr. Jones, asked him for lunch to go to San Diego to see her son, who was at a naval academy high school. It's, I think, called the Army Navy Academy at Point Loma. So he agreed to go with her, and he, I don't know if you noticed that Mr. Jones always wore a little pin on his lapel, and it's a trident. And so they go down to this school, and Mr. Jones is walking around, and everyone is saluting Mr. Jones. And she said, "Who are you?" Because he doesn't make any signs of anything. But he told me about this time when he was out on his ship, and I think he decided he wanted to be in Special Forces, he called it. So he applied, and he hadn't heard. And he asked someone, and they said, "Well, you should have heard by now. Go ask your commanding officer." So he asked his commanding officer if he had, you know, received any letter and any information from this. And he said, no, he hadn't. And it turned out, because Mr. Jones is Mr. Jones and is so valuable as someone to have on your team, that this man, I believe he said, put the letter in the trash, because he wanted to keep him right where he was. Well, he found out that he actually, you know, made the Special Forces and became a Navy SEAL. And I was just looking at something that I know, it's part of the SEAL's creed, and it's just a few little lines, but tell me if this does not just encapsulate Mr. Jones. It embodies him perfectly. My loyalty to country and team is beyond reproach. I humbly serve as a guardian to my fellow Americans, always ready to defend those who are unable to defend themselves. This is the part that I like. I do not advertise my work nor seek recognition for my actions. I serve with honor on and off the battlefield. I like this too. The ability to control my emotions and my actions, regardless of circumstance, sets me apart from other men. Uncompromising integrity is my standard. My character and honor are steadfast. My word is my bond. That is Mr. Jones right there in a few short lines. And I just wanted to say, I'm so humbled to be able to speak with you up here. And what a true gentleman I know Mr. Jones was. We all feel that way. And I'm honored that you allowed me to share a few thoughts with him today. So thank you.
Such a good picture. Our next speaker is the director of Cardin Hall, Mrs. Kim Dablo. Hey, come on up, Kim. I'm going to talk as you come. Kim had probably more hours. Yay! Come up here next to me. Kim had more hours with Dad in conferences, in meetings, and studying how to be a director under him, that there's a real rich connection with Mr. Jones, and I thought we should hear from her. This is Dablo.
Thanks, Dick. In our lifetime, we meet those special people that leave footprints on our hearts, as they say, and in our minds. Mr. Jones was one of them. No matter whether you worked with him daily, as many of us did, were a student in his classroom, and I'm thrilled to see so many ex-students here, or if you knew him from breakfast at the omelet parlor, you were touched by his presence. A true gentleman in every sense of the word, strong but incredibly gentle, one of the most positive and optimistic men I have ever met. And it began each day. If he had had a tough day, the next day, oh, it's a good day. Everything is wonderful. And I love that about him. You don't find that in people very often. Most of the time we hear about all of the problems that people are having. Not from Mr. Jones. Every day he was blessed. Loyal to his family, loyal to Cardinal Hall and all of the staff, but particularly loyal to the students here, past and present. He loved the students. He loved what he did. And he loved the fact that you as students, you as parents, all of us standing here, carry forward what they learned from Mr. Jones. Devoted to bringing out the good in each and every person he met, even Mr. Big at the hardware store, it brought out the good in him. He was a teacher, math, PE, public speaking, certainly with his assemblies. He felt that the assemblies were his classroom. He was always ready to share his knowledge, whether it was about character, or whether it was about tools and how to fix something or help someone else be successful. And I have chosen to talk a little bit about Mr. Fix-It, Mr. Jones, because it's something that for me made him incredibly special as someone who leads an organization. And Mr. Jones was often mistaken on campus in the off hours or on the weekends as the maintenance man. He'd drive around in his three wheels in his very casual duds, and he'd work on sprinklers, he'd work whatever he did. For years, he was the only person that did the maintenance here, from climbing trees, all of the trees, and he was afraid of heights, climbing trees when nobody else was around, trimming trees, digging ditches, finding a sprinkler, redigging it, refixing it, amazing patience. And I've often thought he was our MacGyver, if you know the MacGyver series from years ago on TV. He just loved finding creative fixes. You find them all around Cardin Hall, his home, wherever. He just has just the right fix for something that he creates, he thinks about, and he gets it so it's perfect. He worked on the sets for musicals. He worked in the garage. He did all kinds of things to make Cardin Hall. He spent his weekends here, basically. And he loved that. His plan when he retired was to become the maintenance man at Cardin Hall until Mr. Durante showed up. He would have loved that. It wasn't about being this guy or this guy, or there was nothing of that. He loved fixing things. He also was a gadget guy. Oh my goodness, tools, knives, anything stainless steel. I have an atomic clock in my office because he got one for his office. Scooters, three-wheelers. He just loved gadgets. So I have a little story here. He was always willing to share it with anyone who would listen about his latest gadget. Walked in his office one day and he said, oh, I was at the swap meet over the weekend. That's a problem. It could have been a flag, a nice little thing for the class. No, I got a new knife. I'm sitting there thinking, okay, good, fine. No, I've got to show you this. And he talked about the balance and he popped that puppy open and he showed it. And then he said, you got to put this in your hand. Okay, so I was holding this. Folks, I don't know anything about knives. I had to hand it back for him to close because there's buttons and levers. He loved that. If it was something new, if it had perfect balance, if it was stainless steel, if it was titanium, oh, it was like the best thing. He loved his tools. He loved his, I call them toys. But the thing that was great about that was he came alive when he talked about those things. Joy, enthusiasm. I could have sat there all day just to listen to him about something that I didn't really care about the knife so much, but it was important to him, and he loved those kind of things, so I love them. To sit in the man's presence was a gift. His latest find in this area was the propeller in the hallway. It was just a propeller. When it showed up, he was so excited about it. He spent a long time talking about and thinking about, how am I going to paint that? What's the sign going to say over it? How do I make this meaningful to the students? Red, white, and blue, propelled by patriotism. That was Mr. Jones. Long project, so excited about it because it had to be just right for the students. When I first met Mr. Jones, I was working on the other side of the office, and one day we got to talking about books that we read. And I brought up Louis L'Amour. And this man has read, Mr. Jones had read every single Louis L'Amour. And he talked about the fact that he loved books with heroes. He loved books with strong male characters. And of course, all of those old Western books, there was always a hero, always someone of value, always someone that took a stand for good. Later, though he read lots of history, lots of books about people, and had knowledge beyond belief when it came to historical things, he was such a genuine man, and we had lots of books that we read in common. 2 weekends ago, my iPad lit up and I had 2 downloads. One was the new book by Clive Cussler, Dirk Pitt. The other one was by David Baldacci. I will have to enjoy those even more for Mr. Jones, because we would have talked about both of those authors having new books. He was a man who not only talked about integrity and honesty and all the qualities of character, but who lived by his words. His assemblies taught all of us the importance of striving for excellence, and he expected that we would do it. Masterful storyteller, whether it was about family, sea, whatever it was, I don't think there's anybody on staff who hasn't heard stories over and over, and believe me, we would listen again today if he were here, because it was about the man himself and what he was giving us as he was sharing these stories. Mrs. Bass hinted at this, and I think for me, it's the quality that I love the most about Mr. Jones, and that's humility. For a man of such great importance in your lives, in my life, as you look around, he didn't have a clue how much he meant to all of you, or that he was doing something extraordinary. When the staff and family decided on the 50th anniversary of the school to give a plaque to Mr. and Mrs. Jones to match the plaque from the Cullinanes and the Griswolds and May Carden around the flagpole, he was absolutely shocked. And that plaque sat in his office on a chair for a long time before it went in the ground. And he just said, I just can't believe this. I just can't believe this. That was Mr. Jones. To get a few years, I was talking with Jackie Rubin, who's here, and she did a history of Carden Hall. Mrs. Cullinane was in it. Mrs. Jones was interviewed. Mr. Jones was interviewed. Mrs. Field and I spent weeks trying to get Mr. Jones to agree to do a history. Why would we do that? Why does that matter? We're busy. We're working here. Why does the history matter? And I kept getting calls, are we going to do it? Are we going to do it? And I finally walked into his office and I said, okay, Mr. Jones, I really need a favor. And he said, oh, what is it? I said, I need you to do the history of Carden Hall. And he said, okay. That was the end of it, but it was painful trying to get him to agree. And so it was a lovely thing, but he didn't realize what he was giving, the gift that he was giving, the gift of who he is. There's a saying that was written on the board in the lunchroom the day that the staff was notified of his passing, and I've thought a lot about it. And it says, I teach today to carry the torch lit by another. Thank you, Mr. Jones, for the legacy. I think each of us could say, I live my life today to carry the torch for Mr. Jones. We know what that means. Everybody sitting in this audience wouldn't be here if we didn't see Mr. Jones as a hero, as a mentor, as a teacher, as a friend, as a trailblazer. And when people say to me, there'll never be another Mr. Jones, that's absolutely correct, there won't be. But he has all of us to live up to the standard of excellence that he set. Maybe a little more challenging for us, it's who he was. But I know he would be pleased to have all of you here making that commitment. Thank you.
Whew. Dad messing with the microphone. I made Dad laugh about 2 months ago. I was having breakfast with a friend, and the friend said to me, wait, have you heard this story? If you have, don't interrupt me. I'm dying to tell it again. That's probably Dad in a nutshell. You love that. My next lesson is very, very short. What is essential? What is the principle of the matter? Dad taught me, and I learned so much, to look beneath the surface, beneath the whipped cream, the dressing, the clothing, to find what was at the heart of the matter. It's something I use every day and will always treasure. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to stand for and join us in reading If by Rudyard Kipling. I thought I was going to read this poem until I remembered that it was a father talking to his son about how to be a man. There's no way. I thought, okay, you can do this. I actually tried to read it out loud. I made it the first line and a quarter. Dad used to have a lot of names for me. He called me Buckethead, one of my favorites. And in this moment, I switched to Sprinkler Head. I did make it to the end of the poem. It took me about 10 minutes and about a dozen Kleenex. So I am not going to read If for you. Please welcome, and I'm going to ask you to rise and read along with us, Mrs. Wickie from Carden Hall, who will ride to my rescue. Thank you, Mrs. Wickie. I'd never make it. It's all
Let's do a proper Carden Hall beginning, shall we? If, by Rudyard Kipling, if you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too, if you can wait and not be tired by waiting or being lied about, don't deal in lies, or being hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good nor talk too wise. If you can dream and not make dreams your master, if you can think and not make thoughts your aim, if you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat those two imposters just the same, if you can bear to hear the truth you've spoken, twisted by knaves to make a trap for fools, or watch the things you gave your life to broken, and stoop and build them up with worn out tools. If you can make one heap of all your winnings and risk it on one turn of pitch and toss and lose and start again at your beginnings, and never breathe a word about your loss. If you can force your heart and nerve and sinew to serve your turn long after they are gone, and so hold on when there is nothing in you except the will which says to them, hold on. If you can talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings nor lose the common touch, if neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you, but none too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it, and, which is more, you'll be a man, my son.
Oh, yeah, that one's hard. What a great poem. I'd like to go scooting along because we have some yummy food waiting. What do I say about Greg Kelly? I had a lead-in that was long, and I'm just going to throw it away. What I'd like to say is, in many ways, Greg Kelly, who's speaking on behalf of the alumni, is like my father. He's a really fine human being with a lovely sense of humor, Mr. Greg Kelly.
Good afternoon, friends and family of Mr. Jones. It is a great honor for me to stand here today to celebrate the life of Mr. Jones. When Christy called and asked if I would say a few words, there was not a moment of hesitation. Mr. Jones has been a tremendous influence in my life, as he has been for so many people, and I knew it, I had plenty to talk about. My relationship with Mr. Jones started in 1967, when I was a fifth grade student here at Carden Hall, and we remained in close contact ever since. I think it is most appropriate to begin by talking about his values and his character. It's appropriate to start here because the discussion of character is where every conversation and lesson began and ended with Mr. Jones. I've never met a single person in my life that has lived a life so consistently and with such conviction for doing the right thing. The values that come to mind as I think of Mr. Jones are integrity, fairness, honor, kindness, gratitude, humility, and personal responsibility. He taught these values, he lived these values, and he held each of us accountable for these values. You might look at these values and think a lot of people have these same good qualities. You'd be right. But what separated Mr. Jones from most other people is his courage to stay true to these values no matter what. He never compromised under the pressure of others, and he never took shortcuts to do a quality job. Mr. Jones loved his projects, and he was an accomplished craftsman. He had a workshop like no other. He could build or repair just about anything in his shop here at Cardin Hall. If something needed to be cut, glued, welded, or painted, he could build it or fix it. Mr. Jones wasn't all business all the time. He was the most playful adult you could imagine. I have fond memories of him horsing around with us in the class or out in the field. It was almost a sixth sense knowing when we needed to blow off a little steam. I'm sure it was a little confusing to the other staff just how Nerf balls fit into the May Cardin curriculum. But as students, we never gave it a second thought. I learned to love the game of volleyball through Mr. Jones. This was one sport he wouldn't sit on the sidelines. He loved the game too much to be a spectator. In fact, Mrs. Jones was also quite a competitive volleyball player. We soon learned to never let the two of them on the same team. We only need to learn the lesson of sportsmanship and how to be a gracious loser so many times. We loved playing with him so much we would stay after school for pickup games. Mr. Jones was a successful leader because he was of such high character, pure in his intentions and clear on what he wanted to accomplish. He has been the standard of my life and the benchmark for which I measure all others. Mr. Jones had a passion to see that all his students become better leaders. He would give roles and responsibilities to us at a very young age. It might start with leading the Pledge of Allegiance or the captain of a blue-gold team. No matter what grade you were in, you were felt as if it was up to you to be the role model for the classes beneath you. By the end of our eighth grade year, any one of the graduates could have delivered the keynote address. He had a confidence in us far beyond what we had in ourselves. If we stumbled with an assignment, that was okay and recoverable as long as we fixed it and learned from our mistake. Mr. Jones, you are a courageous leader of utmost integrity. By your example and mentoring, you have inspired us to be better people. You held a torch that lit the way for us in our lives. Your torch never flickered and only grew stronger with time. I can only imagine the countless number of torches you have lit along the way and the collective impact that these people have had on their families and community. Mr. Jones, we'll miss you greatly. Thank you.
Thank you, Greg. Boy, we don't have royalty at Cardin Hall, but if we did, you'd be on the list, sir. One more thought from me as we're coming to a close. In Dad's office, he had a mug with the British slogan from World War II, "Keep calm and carry on." I wanted to put a sticker on that that said, "While you're carrying on, be of good cheer." This has been touched upon by numerous speakers, and I will only say a little more. But I learned from my dad about how to be of good cheer. And for Dad, this did not mean that you were happy all the time. He was a warrior. He knew life was going to happen, and that would involve pain and failure and hardship. What he did know and what he taught me was that I could control my attitude. And I will tell you, my father reset to good cheer faster than any human being I have ever met. And if I aspire to be anything, it is to add that every day to my repertoire. Moving along, one representation of good cheer Dad had was gratitude. And I'd like to take a brief personal moment. Christy and I had the luxury of being with him as he passed. And two people went above and beyond to make that possible. Christy's husband, Mark Kaltoff, and my wife, Marika. Mark has big, broad shoulders, and he works incredibly hard, and Christy works incredibly hard, and he took all of Christy's work for 16 days to let her be here. And my dad was so grateful, Mark. Thank you so much.
Marika, I'm not going to make this without crying, so just deal with it.
I was very strong for my father throughout, and then I would go home and fall into pieces.
And this lady put me back together with duct tape and super glue and good cheer and foot rubs and hugs. And I'm very grateful, and I love you very much.
Now we get to move on to the 23rd Psalm with my sister, Christy. But before I let her get up, I'm going to have a little younger brother revenge. Every younger brother would love to have a microphone when the older sister can't fight back. You knew this was coming. Last night, she told stories about how I was a slow eater, and I just sit there with a smile on my face, knowing that soon I would have a microphone. And she would not. I talked about life lessons, and what I'd like to say about my sister is that she's not going to talk about life lessons. She actually just embodies them. And there are a number of things that Christy has in common with both parents. Hang in there, Mom. And particularly with Dad. And I'm going to speak to a number of those and embarrass her before she comes up. I have a hanky up here for you. It's okay. If you read the bio in there, Christy wrote that. Can you imagine trying to put Mr. Jones into 400 words? Seriously. She did a great job and got it down to 1,200. And Craig said, nope, can't do it. Not in a page. And to edit that down to 400 and still keep the essence of the man was just genius. And she does that. And what I wrote here is 1,001 unseen things. Christy embodies Dad's humility, that things happened in this school behind the scenes that no one ever knew about. No one ever saw. They just got done. And Christy does that. Work ethic. I want you to imagine something. I want you to imagine Al Jones's work ethic. And then I want you to imagine Jane Jones's work ethic. And I want you to shove the two of them together. Right there. She got the double dip and one of the hardest working human beings I've ever met. Steadfast. You could always depend on Al Jones. Always. If he said he was going to do something, he did it. There was never an exception that I can remember in 51 years of knowing him. And Christy has carried that steadfastness into her own life quietly, humbly. She hates public attention and praise about these things. The last thing I'm going to mention is a deep and profound capacity for kindness. If you really knew my father, you knew he had a phenomenal aptitude for kindness. It was quiet and constant. And Christy is one of the kindest human beings I've ever met.
Christy, Dad loved you very, very much. And so do I. Christy Kaltoff and the 23rd Psalm.
I'm so glad to see all your faces here today, and I look forward to visiting with you in a few minutes. First, the 23rd Psalm has always been a favorite in our family. Dad and I recited it many times together during his last days. And even though he spent his life shepherding young students here at Cardin Hall, he knew that all of us need the Good Shepherd. So now, would you please bow your heads as I offer this psalm as a prayer. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you.
Christy and I had the luxury of being there along with Mom as Dad passed, and we spent a lot of time crying together, and she just got me. It says here on my paper, closing remarks. Ooh, we're getting there. So I'd like to start the closing remarks by saying something you don't know about Mr. Jones. And to let you know, we've had some questions. There is an Albert H. Jones Scholarship Fund that some of you have heard of. What is that? No, we're not going to hit you up for donations, although selling Chiclets is a good... Anyway, no. I guarantee you that the Jones family will put the bulk of this money in. If you'd like to contribute, that's lovely. If not, that's lovely too. One thing Mr. Jones did was when there was a family who had their children at Cardin Hall, and life and hardship happened to that family, and then they were unable to pay to have their children continue to come, he always found a way to do that. And once you joined the Cardin Hall family, unless you misbehaved, you were just family. There were some that joined the family and got invited to leave, but by and large. Once you were in, Dad wanted to keep you in, and this scholarship fund is to continue that. And now there's something that you know that I don't know. The Jones family has been utterly tickled and shocked and astonished to hear the stories you have of Mr. Jones. Because for some reason, everybody thinks we have heard them before. Mrs. McRoberts, she told me this wonderful story about getting hired out here on the lawn on a Saturday. I thought that was fabulous. I don't even know where you are, but it was a great story. I loved that. Are you hiding? There you are. Did I get it right? Yeah. And it just, what I'm going to ask is that you please share the stories with us. Write them down, email them in. You can take a video and post it on Facebook. Somehow get those to us, because they have helped immeasurably in the months since Mr. Jones has passed away. We learn so much about Mr. Jones that we didn't know. And every time we keep learning, it gets richer for us, and it will really sustain us over the next years to come. So please share the stories with each other and share with us. Thank you. Okay, we're gonna have some food. It's over there, it's yummy. And please eat hearty. Dad would have eaten heartily, to be adverbial on that. You have to really watch what you say up here in this crowd. It's adverb, has a Lee at the end. Got it. Okay. If you see someone with flowers, they're staff members, please give them a hug and tell them a story. If you would, once we stand to sing the closing hymn, if you would hang out and let the front rows get back there. The Joneses are going to be on some stools all the way in front of the office. We would love to see you. We would love to hug and say hello. However, I don't have time for a 30-minute chat with each of you, as much as I'd love it. So I'm going to hug and, yeah, work with me on that. Okay, after this last bit that I have from Dad to you, I'm going to ask you to stand. And Mrs. Wickey is going to lead us in the singing of the naval hymn. Christy was with Dad when the hymn was sung one time, and Dad said, oh, I love that hymn. It's just, ooh. So we're going to close with the naval hymn. But first, I have one last duty to discharge from my father. So here is a final gift from Dad, given to you through me. Here's the question: how would Dad close this celebration of his life? The answer is, he would not be thinking of himself. He would be thinking of you, unquestionably. So please take a moment and consider your most special, most favorite, most treasured memory of Mr. Jones. And then I'm going to have you do something special with it. Ready, go. This time, instead of sending this memory outward, I'd like you to send it inward. Find a special place for it in your heart. If you receive goodness from Mr. Jones, please understand that he would want that goodness to join your goodness, to meld together. In this way, his gifts would complement your gifts and help you to become the very best human being you could be, to seek excellence. And then he would say, go forth. Go forth to serve. Go forth to love, and go forth to really, really live. Thank you very much. Mr. Jones is rarely without one of these. And if you would please stand, Mrs. Wickie is gonna lead us in the Navy hymn. Thank you. I think I have to lower this.
I would encourage you not to be shy. Don't worry about your voice, but send the message of the words to our dear sailor.